Related group, by the way, Henry V.
Brilliant.
At 5:30, Stuart McConey's Freak Zone.
But right now,
Stephen Merchant.
The Dials, Where Did Our Love Go? I play that because Andy from the band has personally written to me. You see, if Cliff Richard did that at Christmas time, wrote to each individual DJ and said, please play my Christmas single, maybe get some airplay. But instead, he just whinges, perhaps on Richard and Judy. you know, I think it's a valuable lesson learned. If you're in a band and, you know, it could be big or small, you might be Phil Collins. You might be some bloke from Biffy Clyro. If you want your track played on the show, then just write to me. That's clearly the way to do it. And I'm easily swayed by compliments and money. We have so far discovered that Sammy has labelled a three-year-old relative vile, and also everyone who works in Argos Nazis, and Harry has provided very little. What's the most interesting thing that's happened to you this week, Harry?
Well, you know, Steve, I look after a team of six people in the bank where I work, and occasionally you have to send them out on training courses.
Of course.
And the bank very kindly provided a team leadership, or rather a team ethics kind of course. So they sent a load of people away, including the head of the bank.
Ooh.
Like, literally the biggest person in the bank.
While the cat's away.
So this guy had to go on this course with the head of the bank and a load of other people, and... basically, you've got to make a good impression. So they're talking about teamwork and you know, how it should work. And they brought in a guy from the Red Arrows to give a motivational speech. He was saying, you know, well, we're all very individual, but, you know, when we're working as a team, you know, you're flying inches away from your colleagues. So it's all about teamwork and knowing what the other person's doing. He says, so I think teamwork and team ethics are so important. And has anyone got any questions? And this girl from the Bristol office piped up and went, here, yeah, how'd you get the coloured smoke to come out the planes? and of course, the head of the bank just looked horrified.
Yeah.
And he said, well, there's a button we press. and that was it.
Wow.
So yeah, he came back with that report and we chuckled for days.
I read something recently, I don't know where it happened. The Red Arrow, someone went to some kind of event. Was it in the paper? Did I hear it on the radio? Someone said they went to some kind of event and the Red Arrows were billed as turning up. And they went along to this event with the kids, Red Arrows, and the Red Arrows turned up, but just the pilots without the planes, just in, you know, casual clothing.
Yeah.
And apparently they just showed up and went, we're the Red Arrows. Didn't arrive in formation.
No.
Didn't
run around.
That doesn't count, does it? You can't. That's not the Red Arrows, just the blokes.
No, that's not as good, is it?
Particularly lame. Of course, the reason I have people in the studio is not just to offer a bit of frothy banter between records. It's also to introduce me to music. Sammy, your choice first this week, and what have you got for me?
I've got The Postal Service and From Such Great Heights.
BBC Six Music.
Hey there, it's the Steve Show. Six Music. Times...
time's
fast approaching. And here's a great track from an old favourite. So yeah, we'll do is we'll compile a list of generic links, and then we can whack on a sort of greatest hits whenever the weather gets good.
Perfect.
No one will realise.
No one will. That's a great thing, because a lot of local radio stations now, that's all they have, isn't it? It's just a robotic guy. There's not even a real DJ there. It's brilliant. He just records a number of links, normally involving, and a great one from Simply Red. That's all he needs to say, and he's covered. But also, people have often been complaining that the show's perhaps not public service enough.
Mm.
And to that end, I was digging around on the web and I found this. This is quite fun. Play this, dude.
Hi, this is James Brown, soul brother number one. Always fighting. Now I'm fighting for your life. I'm fighting for your life because if you use drugs, you better leave it alone. Drugs are contagious. They're killers. Every drug is a killer. Stay away from drugs. Drugs will take your life away. And if you want to live, stay away from drugs. Because they are super bad, super bad, super bad, super bad.
What I like about that is that it appears as though he's on drugs while recording
yeah,
it.
Yeah.
And it's the idea that he's just clearly making it up as he goes along.
Yeah.
And the best he can offer is they're super bad.
Isn't super bad good?
But I thought Super Bad was pretty funky.
I thought Super Bad was pretty good.
But this is a man, of course, who later walked into an office adjacent to his building, high on PCP, with a shotgun, threatening a group of people because he thought, in his paranoid delusions, that they'd used his toilet. and so it's just odd that they would ever have recruited him to be a drugs advocate. But I just think, you know, if you are thinking of taking drugs, maybe you're in a park as we speak, listening on a digital radio, you're just sparking up a fat one, or, you know, you're off your eyeballs on that. What's the horse tranquilizer? You dip in your eyes.
Mong balls.
Yeah, if you're if you're dosed up on mong balls, if you are dosed up on mong balls, get in touch. 64046 stephen.6music@bbc.co.uk. Tell us what the sensation's like.
Maybe we could lay down a funky beat, and someone on mong balls could tell us not to take mong balls.
Not to take. But anyway, I thought it was as James Brown is. I think he's just been buried. I felt that like it was a long time coming, but the Steve Show's not yet actually celebrated the passing of James Brown. Not, I don't mean we celebrate him. Obviously, we celebrate his great work, and obviously we commiserate his passing. But anyway, here's some James Brown. And I remember exactly where I was when I first heard that. although it wasn't 1964, it was actually about 3 or 4 weeks ago. It was just a do. I'm not going to name the do. It was high class. It was just a do. That's all I'm going to say. I obviously, and Sammy may not be aware of this, she's too young, but I have had some success in the world of television. All right?
Really?
Yeah. And one of my erstwhile colleagues is TV funny man Ricky Gervais. Okay, and I've been working with him of late, and he is a man who likes to eat out at lunchtime. It angers me because I'll happily bring sandwiches. I will bring sandwiches to work, and I will pop them in some foil or a carrier bag, recycle, and I will bring them into work, and that's fine. It saves me money. I don't need much to eat at lunchtime. That's more than enough. But he loves to eat out. Got a little bit of money in his pocket. Loves to eat out at some kind of restaurant. You know, maybe a bit of pasta. No starter, straight in with the pasta. And he loves to do that most weekdays, okay? Which angers and infuriates me because it costs a fortune. I don't need that much to eat at lunchtime. This week, we're sat out. It's quite good weather. He demands to sit outside, right? You know, he's got his sunglasses. I've got nothing. I'm burning up. I'm sat right under the sun. I burn easily. And we're sat there. And a homeless guy comes up. I'm furious, right? Straight away, I'm thinking, oh, because you don't want a homeless guy, you know, bothering you, do you, when you're eating grub? Because it's just annoying, isn't it? You know, there should be a sort of boundary. They can sell you a big issue when you're walking down the street, but not if you're sat outside while eating, okay? So he's there, and he leans over, he recognises us. He says, all right, guys, hello, listen. Anything you've got would help me out, anything. So Ricky goes in his pocket. He's got £1.20, right? He comes out, he gives the guy £1.20. The guy goes, thanks very much. He goes, Steve, anything, Steve? I went in my pocket, right, 20p, I had. I went, how about that? He went, oh, anything you can do, mate. Anything you can do to help me out, mate. He's one of those quite pushy homeless guys. And I said, that's all I've got. He went, anything you can do, mate. He's obviously not going to accept the 20p. I was hoping he would just go, 20p, brilliant, thanks very much, and hop off into the day. But he didn't. So I thought, oh, God. So I opened the wallet. It's dangerous, isn't it? It's dangerous. Because once you've opened the wallet, you've got to take something out. You can't just look in there, see the notes, and think, well, you're having none of them, mate. So I opened the wallet. Of course, now other people at other tables are looking in, right? I'm saying to Rick, you got anything? He's going, no, I'm just giving him £1.20. Open the wallet. All I had, £20 note. £20 note, all right? Unbelievable. It was a burn, mate. Yeah. It was a burn. So I looked at the 20, and I thought, genuinely, I thought, can you ask for change? Because weirdly enough, we'd done this on the show itself.
Yeah, on extras. Yeah.
We'd actually discussed this as an idea. And I thought, I don't know what the rule is, because can you ask for it? I don't know what the rule is. So I looked at this £20, and it's like time slowed down. And I looked at him, and his kind of greedy little eyes looked back at the 20, and Ricky was just about to burst with laughter. He cannot believe it's luck that I'm in this situation. And I'm just looking at this 20, and I thought, well, there's nothing to do. The people at other tables are watching, their eagle eyes are looking. I'm thinking any one of those could text Heat saying that Steve's trying to haggle with a homeless guy. £20. I took it out. Do you know what? I was so angry with this guy who was just trying to get some money to eat, to live, that I just gave it to him contemptuously. Didn't even look at him. I just went, there you are. Frustrated. He went, thank you so much. That's made my day. I bet it bloody made your day. And he wanders off, happy as Larry. I couldn't even look at him. I was so angry. Ricky's in hysterics. I mean, crying. Do you know what I mean? Like, couldn't eat. He was just doubled up with laughter. And then, of course, so that meant that it cost me, like, about £15 for the meal and £20 on top of that. It's like a £35 lunch. £35, could have bought some corned beef sandwiches for about 20p. I was furious. So that guy's bounced off into the day, happy as Larry. And there I am, £20 down.
Can you have just bought him a bowl of pasta from the restaurant?
So it would have been cheaper.
Shouted him dinner, because he's probably only going to spend it on crack, isn't he?
It would have been cheaper, you're absolutely right, to invite him to join us for dinner than to have given him
that
20.
That is a picture for Heat. The three of you at the table.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Generous Ricky and Steve. Come to home, this guy. Oh, goodness me. So now there's obviously two things I can do. One is, I mean, if I'd had... Because sometimes I actually bring in sandwiches anyway.
I was going to say, I thought you were going to give the traveller sandwiches.
Wouldn't that be amazing?
So just carry safety sandwiches.
Safety sandwiches.
Yeah.
Just
yeah.
Give in the sandwiches.
Answer.
Is that permissible?
Oh, yeah. God, yeah.
I was thinking of just carrying sort of 50p in that bus ticket pocket in my jeans. Yeah. And then I can always whip that out straight away. Give that to him.
Or just sign something and say, tell you what, mate.
Pop it on eBay.
Do you use eBay?
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Just give it to him. He can flog it.
Well, I don't know. I mean, so all I'm saying is, if you recall, a couple of weeks back for Comet Relief, I donated, Sammy, you may not remember this, I donated my entire fee to Comet Relief.
On about
can we just
this.
Top it's this sickening. Up, right? Fee, and now I've given £20 to a homeless person, all right? So at the end of the year, we'll just look back on just how generous I've been, all right? Spread the wealth. I'm like Robin Bloody Hood. Okay, now each week we'd like to add a song to our Songs to Seduce Women By CD. And we've had some cracking tunes in the past. And I thought it'd be nice to just lay down a tune which I think evokes kind of maybe sort of the teenage years when romance is first blossoming. And that's why I've chosen Magic in the Air for Badly Drawn Boy. It's The Steve Show, BBC Six Music, with me, Stephen Merchant, and that's from a new EP featuring kind of assorted remixes of The Decemberists, and that's their track, The Perfect Crime, number two. So it's a Steve Show, as I say, and before we get to Pigeonhole tracks, we will have a choice from our friend Rufus, super posh. And before I mention that, we've had a number of texts and emails and so on talking about how they have discovered an ancient piece of archive footage of my good self, SJ Merchant, when I appeared on Blockbuster. Now, let's clear something up. Firstly, I was not on the classic Blockbusters with Bob Holness. I was on a revived version for BBC Two, hosted by Michael Aspel. A lot of people were saying, Steve, surely you were a sixth former, you took on a novelty toy. No, I did not. I was, I think, post-university, embarrassingly, so I was actually in my adult life. So then, the next obvious question is, why did you bother, Steve? Let me explain. My friend, who I'd grown up with, had been on there in classic Blockbuster days, and he'd said it was a debauched old time. I mean, I don't want to, you know, I don't want to sort of cast aspersions on some of those old Blockbusters contestants, but apparently it was quite decadent. You know, a lot of sixth formers, you know, in a hotel room for, you know, sometimes up to a week. Oh, apparently there were some hijinks. There was some naughtiness, you know. I finished university. I'm between jobs. I'm thinking, why not? I'll spend a week or so in a hotel, you know. Hopefully there'll be some similar filth going on. So I trundle up to Manchester. Oh, no! What's happened here? They've opened the doors not to, hot young people, elderly women, middle-aged bikers, all sorts of people. There was not a pretty face to be seen. There was not anyone, I think, under the age of 40 except me. I'd originally intended to go on with my friend, who was quite the brain box, but his sister had driven us to the audition, and they thought that would be a more interesting selling point, the sister and our brother double act. So I, of course, stuck on my own. Now, anyone who's watched Blockbusters surely remembers that the two versus one idea was never fair. It was never, ever fair. Despite the fact that you supposedly only had to make yourself, you had to get maybe four questions right to their five or something. Never thought it was fair. I was terrified of this problem. I was confronted with it. I had no option. You know, I didn't want to back out now. So I went up to Manchester, where it was being recorded. Stayed in a hotel. And, oh, it was agonising. Because everyone was in bed by about 6:30 in the evening. I was sat there in the bar on my own, nothing going on. It's dead. All the promises I'd had of, you know, wild times, nothing to be found. My friend and his sister, they went on early in the week, and they did quite well, got onto a gold run or something. They went off. I was stuck there on my own in Manchester, and actually, I'll be honest with you, quite nervous, because I thought I was quite a smart aleck, but then I was beginning to think, actually, maybe I'm not quite the brainiac that I thought I was. So, we trundle along. Eventually, I get down there after ages waiting. And we get down there, and I'm there versus these two women. Now, I can't remember people who've seen this clip. Apparently, now it's made it onto YouTube. I don't know who's got this. I don't know how it's found its way onto the web. But anyway, I shouldn't even put it on there. And if only I'd had the forethought, because now I've said this, obviously, a lot of people are going to go on the web and start passing it around. If only I'd had the forethought all those years ago to say something at the end. Like when he said, hey, who are you? I'd have said, hi, Steve Merchant. I'm hoping one day that my box set of The Office will be available on DVD. If only I'd had that forethought, it could have been a fantastic viral advertising campaign. Sadly, there is nothing. Although, apparently, I think I do say I'd quite like to be a comedy writer, so, you know, nice to see my dreams came true. But I'm fairly certain that one of the first questions was something like, which Y sang with the Plastic Population? Yes, I was straight in. I had no fanning around. I was straight in there. I thought, I am off to a flying start. I'm going to wipe the floor with these two women. I got the next two questions right, as I recall. I thought, this is unbelievable. I am extraordinary. All those years of playing Trivia Pursuit at Christmas, it obviously paid off. Oh, then the tables turned. They'd obviously got a certain confidence that they'd had from just from being there relaxing. The lights had come on and everything. They were a bit nervous to begin with. They started to find their feet. They were getting in. They were buzzing so fast. I think there's a confidence when there's two people that maybe the one person doesn't have. They think, I don't know, I'm just keep doing the buzzer noise now. But anyway, I'm trying to give you a flavour of the excitement of the whole event. And so they're buzzing in, they're getting those questions. And of course, I'm thinking I know the answers, but I'm just not getting fast enough to the buzzer. It was so embarrassing. So we're trundling away. I'm thinking, okay, you may as well just put me out of my misery. Because it's clear these girls are going to wipe the floor with me. I'm thinking, just put me out of my misery. But just before we get to the final question, that's just going to be the final nail in my coffin, Aspel, he goes, well, we've not got any more time on the show. Steve, can you come back tomorrow? I thought, come on, Michael, you're having a laugh. Just kill me now. I said, yes, of course, Michael, yes. So, like you, lights come on, that was it. The end of that, I had to go trundling all the way back to the hotel. Another night, you know, all I could do, there was nothing to do, as I didn't know anyone in Manchester. All I could do was just take baths. Baths in the giant hotel bath. That was all I seemed to do, just take endless baths, worrying about my pitiful performance on Blockbusters. I go down there the next day, sit in the seat, the guy, Aspel, says, okay, well, if Steve doesn't get this next question right, he's out. Let's play Blockbusters. Steve, you've not got that question right. You're out. Thanks for playing Blockbusters. It was so pathetic. I was rubbish. I was embarrassing. He then, for some reason, got me up on the hotspot and compared heights. He went back to back, Steve. So it was me and Aspel, back-to-back on one of the gold spots or whatever it's called. Oh, the whole thing was a tortuous and humiliating experience, made worse by the fact that when the cheque arrived for the £15 that I'd won, there was a kind of piece, a jagged piece, missing from one corner, as though, as the person who was writing the cheques had written it, they were so contemptuous of my pitiful display that they'd just torn the cheque out without even bothering to kind of carefully get it out. So there was half the cheque was left behind. Oh, sod it. Some stupid oik from Bristol. And despite the fact that I did write quite a droll article for a local magazine, I thought it was something that would just lie there in the BBC2 archives, never come back to haunt me. Now it's back, it's here, everyone can see the humiliation, everyone can see my different glasses. I had a different pair of glasses, so what? Sue me. Everyone can see the youthful Steve, everyone can see that I'm enthusiastic, and then that the life is crushed out of me by two women who, I don't know who those women are, I don't know where they are now, I hope they've gone on to great things. I'm hoping I've had the last laugh. Who knows?
I'm just wondering how long it's going to take for someone to just listen again to this show and then just edit what you've said onto a kind of director's commentary of the YouTube clip.
Of course.
That's it's going to be, yeah, idea. That was, well, I did it for a laugh, and there's just going to be you silently mouthing in the background.
Yeah, yeah, that's another fantastic idea. Thanks for suggesting
that's
that.
That's all right.
Celebration.
Hot yes. In on the text front, one of the people who was playing against you posted it up. She looks like David Walliams. Jasmine.
Oh, one of the people who's playing against me.
Yeah.
Really interesting. Okay. Obviously, I mean, I've not looked at it. I don't go back to the clip. Never go back. Never revisit the past. So I've not looked at it. I don't know just how humiliating the defeat is. I remember it was bad. I remember it was painful. It certainly made me wary of being involved with quizzes. Now I will sometimes not even play Trivia Pursuit in a, you know, party situation. I'll often be quiz master rather than the quizzy. But yeah, if you've not seen it, then you know, obviously feel free to check it out. And it's pretty painful. That's all I'm gonna say. Hazy Shade of Winter from the Bangles, which was recorded in 1987 for the film Less Than Zero. It was on the soundtrack to that. So there you are. I know what the hell I'm talking about. So earlier on, I was just recalling the misery that was my Blockbusters experience. And remarkably, one of my nemeses, is that the word? Nemesises? That's exactly the reason I don't know that information, is exactly the reason I did so poorly on Blockbusters. This person will know the answer to that, the plural of nemesis, the nemeses, nemesis. Anyway, are you there? Hello?
Hi.
All right, now, forgive me, because I've not watched this clip since we recorded it, so I cannot remember who you are.
Okay, I'm Rupam.
Right.
I'm the one with the dark hair.
Okay, and you were one of my nemeses.
That's right.
And how do I know that you're not just a crank? Is there anything you can recall about that event, the Blockbusters experience, that could only be known by us contestants?
I remember talking to you after the show, and you told me that all your friends were going to take the Mickey because you didn't get the Emilio Estevez question right.
Oh, it was
a film student.
Was there an Emilio Estevez question?
There were, well, Charlie Sheen, Martin Sheen.
So some kind of Estevez Sheen question.
Yeah.
See, even now I've blanked it out. Isn't that embarrassing?
Fine.
So let me just clear this up. So let's just paint the picture. I don't remember exactly. Were we introduced beforehand, or was it the first time that we met when we were actually on the show?
I think we met when we actually just went up
right
onto the stage.
And I had quite a sort of strange and lonely time staying in this hotel in Manchester. Was that your experience?
it wasn't. We were really upset because we didn't get to stay in the hotel. We got taxied back to Leeds.
Oh, okay. That where you that's where you come from.
Yeah. Well, it's where I was living then.
Let me fill in some of the other blanks. How old were we, you, at that time?
I was 27.
27?
I was a mature student.
This is what I mean. You know, I was a babe in arms. How could I have competed with you? Was your compadre also that old?
But also, I mean, I am a quiz queen.
Okay, interesting. So you were a quiz queen, and how does one become a quiz queen? You just enter every kind of pub quiz and whatnot?
Quiz, but I think I was queen of that quiz.
You were indeed. And since then, what's happened? Have you gone on to other? Have you been on other game shows?
No, I haven't. I didn't want to sully the memory of
no.
my triumph.
Well, you sullied it in some ways by putting it on the web. Was it you who actually popped it on the web?
Yes, it was.
Thank you very much indeed. I appreciate it. Because you know now that will haunt me forever. It will be perpetually dragged out on occasional chat show appearances and whatnot. Thanks very much indeed. Have you got any shots of me dancing around in my pants you'd like to stick on the web? what drove you at the age of 27 to go on? Obviously, I've already explained my reasons for going on Blockbusters, which was I was led to believe it would be wild nights running up and down hotel corridors and throwing things out of windows. That was not the case. I just took long baths and just thought about where my life was leading me. Well, what was your reason?
Well, I think because we were students at the time and we were a bit bored,
yeah.
And somebody saw an advert for the audition, so we went on. But we had to audition for it, did you?
Well, yes, kind of, but I think the audition was just, you know, I mean, they came to Bristol and they tried to find people that could sort of string a sentence together, and I was one of the eight that could. So it wasn't too much of a problem. No, I'm being unnecessarily cruel, but there was a big old room in a hotel somewhere, and we all had to sort of answer questions, I think, and fill in a questionnaire or some such.
Yeah, that's what we had to do as well.
Now, were you nervous as you sat down behind the desk?
Yes, I was. And I'm nervous now. I can feel my heart pounding.
What was? It's nice to be. It's nice to be able to turn the tables at last because you seem very relaxed on the day. We might drum up some questions for you later. Test you on music trivia. Now this is something this always plagued me. I've always, part of my excuse has always been that there must be a confidence that you gain when there's two of you on a team as versus one person, that you could lunge for the buzzer much quicker, safe in the knowledge that there's a chance the other person will know the answer, even if you're the one who's buzzed. Is that how it worked, or did you have to think of yourself as an individual player?
If I buzzed, I had to answer the question.
Damn it! I always presumed that was the reason I was so hopeless, that you were just buzzing in the hope that, well, damn, that's...
No, I was just buzzing because I knew the answers.
And so you're a proper old boffin.
I've just started at university again to do a bit more studying.
And so what have you done in the interim?
I was a teacher for 2 years.
Oh, this is not fair.
And then I gave that up and started working in the NHS. So I'm now, well, until last week, I was an NHS manager.
Sure.
Which now, is not very exciting, really.
My final question is, I can't remember what happened. Did you go on to win loads of great stuff on Blockbusters?
Yeah, we did.
Thanks very much. There was no qualms there. She was straight out with that, rubbing salt in the wound. Go on, what did you win?
We won helicopter flying lessons.
Helicopter flying lessons? I dream of helicopter flying lessons. Right, flying lessons.
The only reason I've put it in the plural, though, is because there were two of us, so we won one each.
Great.
But still, and then we won a trip to Iceland, to Reykjavik.
Oh, wow. Man alive.
So we went out there and partied for a very long weekend.
That sounds fantastic. My, I suppose my final question is: how many BAFTAs have you got? Nice, good. Keep your digs at bouncers coming in 6446 steven.6music@bbc.co.uk. We'll squeeze in some Wilson Pickett, then we'll have the news. Those and dances. That's a song actually which has been covered by many people, including Bill Haley, the Jay Giles Band, Patti Smith, and apparently Vinnie Jones on his 2002 album Respect.
I imagine that's very good.
Imagine if you've actually heard that Vinnie Jones album, then keep it to yourself. It's the Steve Show. We'll be back after the news with more stuff. Familiar to fans of the film The Big Lebowski, of course, because it's used in the sort of psychedelic dream sequence. That's just dropped in to see what condition my condition was in. By Kenny Rogers and First Edition, a little bit of interesting trivia for trivia fans. The backwardsy guitar bit at the beginning is played by Glenn Campbell.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And thanks. And the song was produced by Mike Post.
You're kidding.
No.
Posty.
I tell you why you're excited about that, because Posty, of course, became well known for composing almost every American TV theme tune of the 80s. He did famously, of course, Hill Street Blues, and also The A-Team. And The A-Team has always been, I think, the marker for me of a great theme tune, because it obeys a simple Steve rule, which is that you can sing the words of the show and the show's title to the song. The A-Team, the A-Team, the A-Team, the A-Team. Yeah. Therefore making it one of the greats. And I think that if you notice that a lot of the great memorable theme tunes, you can use that rule to test it. For instance, Last of Summer Wine. The Last of the Summer Wine.
Yeah.
The Last of the Summer Wine. Works beautifully.
See, Emmerdale Farm blew it when they dropped the farm. Because it used to be Emmerdale Farm, do-do-do-do, Emmerdale Farm. But now it's just Emmerdale, it doesn't scan properly.
Which is exactly right. Whereas Coronation Street, Coronation Street. Coronation Street.
And of course,
perfectly.
Hello, 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 hello,
hello, hello, hello, hello, hello, hello, hello. Yeah, no, exactly. So, I believe as well the 10 o'clock news, the ITV 10 o'clock news works quite well. No, it doesn't.
No, it doesn't at all.
Okay, thank you very much for listening. If you are still listening, we've enjoyed some wonderful tunes. Sorry, I got sidetracked there. We were talking about bouncers before the news. We should probably wrap that up because it will become interminable. We have a few final emails and texts. One from Michael who says, I was once stopped while trying to enter a bar by a bouncer for the very crime of wearing trainers, of course. I meekly protested, and whilst giving me some astute sartorial advice, you want to tidy yourself up a bit, mate, the bouncer stopped mid-flow to wave past a guy with a giant spiderweb tattooed on his face. His entire face. The Spider-Man had the forethought to pop on a nice pair of loafers. Of course he did. That's how he's getting in.
That's quality. We've got one here as well, Steve. A fellow who wasn't allowed into Tiger on Haymarket in London because he had jeans on. And he said, it's the whole package. It's not just the jeans. It's the whole package. I like the idea that they give advice. It's nice.
So that was the bouncer was saying that.
Yeah, it's like he's turning him away, but he's saying, look, you know, you just need to sort yourself out, fella. You know, make a few changes, a few life changes. You made some bad decisions.
Thinking, you mentioned before about Karen, who emailed in and said that she slept with a bouncer once. He was rubbish.
Yeah.
I'm thinking she should have turned the tables on him.
Yeah.
And as he was about to, you know, finish the act, she should have said, don't like the look of that, mate.
Yeah.
You're not getting in here.
Yeah. Groups of men, no more than three at once.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. No sight close. It would have been, but you know, there you are. It's so often the way, isn't it, that after the event, you think of what you should have said later. I appreciate all the emails and texts. Thank you very much indeed for that. Each week, of course, we like to get the people here in the studio to contribute a song choice. That is very much the nature of the show. People recommend tunes. You, the listeners, will be doing that later. Harry is with us. He has a tune which he is going to suggest to me that I might like.
I have. It's called Lonely Still. It's by Jesse Sykes and the Sweet Hereafter.
Should I be familiar with them?
Probably not. No. She sort of does a kind of country goth type thing, similar to the Handsome Family, I guess. But my reason for picking it, I used to live in Bristol and I had a flat above a very sort of spiteful, hateful little man who used to just constantly row with his wife. And when he was upset, after he'd had a row with his wife and she'd stormed out, which happened a lot of the time, in the middle of the night, he would play Fields of Gold by Sting on repeat. I once stayed awake for 3 hours as that single song was played on repeat. And I'm like, well, melancholy should be quite a noble thing, and you're doing it a disservice if you're playing tat like that when you're upset. And I think if I was going to play a song sort of 30 times in a row, then get armed up and slay everyone in my local quick save, then this is probably the song that I'd want to play.
But in terms of my poshness, that's taken quite a leap.
Really? I didn't think you could get any posher. But
found out last weekend I'm directly related to Joan of Arc's brother, Pierre.
Wow. Wow, directly related as well.
How can you be directly related to the brother and then not her?
She didn't have any children, but he did. So I think that's how it works. I'll bring the family tree in.
She's a distant aunt of some kind.
Great, 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 until about 4 o'clock. Aunt.
I bet there is no one else on Six Music, nay the BBC, who can say that they've got a direct link to Joan of Arc's brother, Pierre. Is there any more to ask about this? Because I'm intrigued to know how you find this information out.
It was a series of family trees. You know, Steve, as you know, most evenings I spend with a cigar, a decanter of sherry in front of a roaring fire with a bell push and a valet.
Of course, yeah.
Going through old manuscripts.
Of course you do.
And on this particular evening, I was just going through some old family trees, reading some old Guernsey family history.
Sure.
And someone said, tell you what, here's a find. everyone, yeah. Listen up, cleared the throat, read something out in French, and then we roughly translated it.
Of course you did.
Into approximate English, and made that startling discovery.
Wow, yeah. That's extraordinary. And the manuscript, presumably you lent on a bust on a mantelpiece, yeah, a secret door opened.
Yeah.
And there it was.
And there it was. The treasure of Joan of Arc is now probably mine.
Wow, this is extraordinary, because it's not... Was Joan of Arc, is she now Saint Joan? I think, hasn't she achieved sainthood?
I think she did become saint.
Wow, so maybe you're the heir to something. It could be like the Da Vinci Code.
Yeah.
There must be some way we can exploit this for financial gain.
Yeah, that's why that's the first thing I thought, obviously. You got any ideas, Harry?
No, I'm just taken aback by the whole thing, really.
Yeah.
Harry, can you just go on? I want you to go online and see if you can dig up some information about Pierre. I'm interested to know. There might be... Because it's interesting, of course, that the I think the Daily Telegraph, unbeknownst to me, did a kind of Steve family tree. It has a little sort of section. And what was brilliant was, on both sides of my family, there's not a single person who was anything other than utterly poor. I mean, I'm seriously, there's criminals, and what's bizarre is we have the surname Merchant, not a single merchant in our past. Not a single, I come from Bristol, we could have been sugar merchants, we could have been slave merchants. There's a lot of opportunities for us there, and we did not exploit it. And I think presumably at some point just some distant relative just said, oh yeah, I'm a merchant, was down the pub, what do you do? Yeah, I'm a merchant. that stuck, but we've got absolutely nothing in our background.
Yeah, welcome to my world.
Really?
Gypsies, criminals. That's just the stuff scratching the mere surface.
And that's just your father.
That's just my dad.
BBC Six Music.
BBC Six Music.
All right, listen, we've got the news very shortly, but in the meantime, let's hear, we have our regular covers session where I play a popular cover choice. This one, I'm sure everyone's heard it before, but it's always worth hearing again. Let's quickly hear the jingle.
Mr. Cover Cover.
I think it might be racist. This is Johnny Cash and One. From Diamond Dogs, 1974. David Bowie and Rock and Roll With Me. An amazing tune. I'm not even sure that was a single. That's the stuff he just sticks on an album, buries it away on an album that probably sold, a million copies. So there we are. You've never been a David Bowie fan, have you, Harry?
Not massively, no. But I did like Suede at the time because I was a young kid, and that song is basically Stay Together by Suede, So I think David Bowie nicked it off him.
have you re-evaluated your musical tastes as a youth?
I got it all wrong.
Sure. Listen, let's not lie to anyone. We are not live. We are on tape. If you've just joined us, it has been a mediocre show. I'm not going to lie to anyone. I'll tell you what it is. We realised, I didn't think that the adrenaline of the live experience is what made us the kind of major broadcasters we are. But it turns out that is the case. And so next week, obviously, we'll be back live, firing on all cylinders. I apologise for that. If you're expecting us to cheer up your Sunday afternoon, in actual fact, you found it to be a bit dull. At one point, I even referred to Dano Groats. I was trying to explain Land's End to John O'Groats, and I just said Dan O'Groats. And,
why not?
And the reason I mentioned Dan O'Groats at all was because, of course, each week we've been catching up with our friend Dave, who, for no very good reason, has been walking from Land's End to Dan O'Groats, which is up in Scotland. And we don't really know why he's doing it. We've never really got to the bottom of that. He's certainly not doing it for charity, which is very, very perverse. We're catching up with Dave again now. Dave, are you there?
I am, Steve.
Now, of course, this is very bizarre. Because we are pre-recording the show, we have to just speculate where you might be when this show is being broadcast. So this is about, what, a week, 2 weeks before?
We're about 10 days out.
About 10 days out. So where roughly do you think you'll be in 10 days' time?
Well, it's a ludicrous idea. I don't know where I'm going to be tomorrow. if you need adrenaline, I've got plenty of it. I think it's all that's keeping my legs together. But I can stick my finger in the air, and I reckon I will be, by the time this is actually going out, somewhere in the Pennines, maybe Hebden Bridge area around Halifax.
Okay.
Either that or in Southern California, and the way it's going at the moment, I may just pop in a flight over.
Well, you might just pack it all in. Is it not going well? Has it been a difficult week?
Well, I'm sure next week it will have been a difficult week.
Okay, this is amazing. This is so postmodern, isn't it? So let's assume, because we're going to be speaking to you soon for the live show, let's just not talk about this week. Let's talk about the imaginary next week.
Okay.
So where will you have slept last night, Dave?
Well, I would have spent a bad night in Wolverhampton. Possibly is as good as it gets around there. Yeah. And I get the feeling that someone's going to throw golf balls at me.
Why?
Probably not as ludicrous or as far-fetched as it might sound.
Why might they throw golf balls at you?
I really can't go into it, but it will happen.
Sure. Sure. Now, we've been trying to piece together why it is that you're doing this, and
we often have been describing you as almost a sort of an existential hero in some respects, a man who's perhaps a little lost in the universe, like all of us, but a man who wears it on his sleeve, and maybe is trying to discover exactly why he has been put on this planet, and maybe he thought that by doing this preposterous walk, not for charity, that you would somehow add to something. And you've denied that. Sometimes you've said to me, you know, Steve, no, I'm not like that. I'm not a dark soul. I'm not a twisted soul. I'm just a guy doing a walk. Well, I'm going to find a piece of evidence, which I think maybe disputes that, because if you recall, some time ago, you sent me a compilation, Dave. You sent me many, and this is part of the reason we have you on the show, because you're going to suggest a great tune for us. But you sent me a compilation, and you included in that a quote in this compilation. I don't know if you remember that.
No.
And I know it was probably only for my eyes. You know, you probably thought that it was a private thing between two friends. But no, we're now going to broadcast it to the half a dozen people still listening to the show.
Yeah, go on, share everything.
You lifted a quote
between us.
You lifted a quote from the Seventh Seal.
Uh-huh.
Antonius Block, which I think is the main character in that. And this is the quote, Dave. Now, okay, I may have painted you wrongly, all right, but here's the quote. Through my indifference for people, I've been placed outside of their society. Now I live in a ghost world enclosed in my dreams and imaginings. That's not Timmy Bannett speaking, is it?
Well, I don't really quite know what to say. You probably sounded clever at the time.
I mean, it's a beautiful quote, and it's beautiful in its poetry, and I feel many often the same way.
It's a great film, Steve.
It's a great film, but I just wonder, is there a sort of darkness at the heart of Dave?
I've never looked within, and I'd really rather not start doing it now.
I think we're going to break him by the end of this walk. I think by the time he reaches Dan O'Groats, he's going to be a broken man. He's going to break down in tears on the end of the phone, and it's going to be a really moving experience, and maybe even award-winning.
You'd like that, wouldn't you?
I would love that, Dave.
That really, all that this, you know, broadcasting thing is that you're sticking your foot out, and you're waiting for me to fall.
That's exactly right.
Huge.
I'm sticking out one of my giant size 14s and waiting for you to fall flat on your face.
And there'll be a big finger pointing at me and laughing, and it'll be your finger, Steve, and your laughing.
My finger laughing?
And the only thing that's really keeping me going next week, which is really last week, is the fact that I want to prove you wrong personally.
Great. Okay, well, good. Now, this is interesting now, because there's a sort of conflict now. There's a little tension here, which is exciting. And the idea
I'm glad you've noticed it at last.
It's great. Listen,
5 weeks or whatever.
Well, listen, we'll be back live to catch up with you next week, which is obviously in 2 weeks, which is so confusing, we just have to play some music now and move on. But we will speak to you again very soon, and obviously we wish you all the best in your continued adventure.
Wish me all the best or not? I can't quite make it out.
Yes, I wish you all the best in your continued adventure. All right. Sorry, we'll cut out any of the dead bits. So which tune have you chosen for us?
Okay, the tune is particularly cheerful. It's Patty Griffin, Tomorrow Night. It's beautiful from 2002, sorry. And it's soul music, Steve. Pure and simple.
More. Right, if it's not the right version, Rufus, we're not playing it. If you want a specific version, mate, and it's not being provided by the BBC, you are not going to suffer if you didn't get the right version.
Anyone who's stepping the foot to that, I'm sorry, I've let you down. I haven't brought the right version in myself. I thought the BBC had it. I thought there was only one version. I didn't know he was tootling around with Kenny G in the background. They were having a terrible time, weren't they, with that? I'm sorry, everyone. I'm sorry, John Martin, if you're listening, because I know he's a fan.
Yes, I know. Well, if you recall, I played some John Martin a couple of weeks back, and I had the same problem.
Exactly.
I don't know what the BBC's version of John Martin library is, but it ain't the one I've got.
He's got two back catalogues. One brilliant and earthy, the other one absolute studio. I was hoping for a bit where a plane went past and it would go from one speaker to the other.
Yeah.
I was hoping that never did.
That clearly was not recorded in someone's back garden.
Really, no, wasn't. Not at all.
Whoever played that saxophone had never been outside, let alone recorded the song outside.
That was actually recorded, I suspect, at a branch of Smolensky's. Oh, I used to go in Smolensky's occasionally near me because there was a guy with a piano. And I'd walk in, he'd just go, there is a lineman. And it was great. It was just beautiful. And once I remember he walked in, he just saw me. I just gave him the nod. He just went, never seen you looking so lovely as you did tonight. He knew.
Literally, it's like the lyric that game went over my head. I have no idea what you just referred to, and I'm going to be honest and put my hands up and go, what?
What, Lady in Red?
Lady in Red. No, Smolensky.
Smolensky's. Well, I'm afraid, I think I've got a feeling they may have gone under. I can't confirm that.
No.
Oh, they're still going, are they?
Fine, yeah.
There was one near me.
You're thinking of Quicksave.
You're right, yeah. Or FOP. Yeah. Oh, I love that she... Oh, you can't joke about FOP on Six Music. The Six Music list is up in arms. You can joke about Diana, but no FOP. Don't mention FOP.
Rufus, what's the most interesting that happened to you this week?
Well, Steve, just to change the tone slightly, you know that I move in certain exalted circles.
Yes,
you
you're very posh.
I'm quite posh. I'm constantly on the lookout for people posher than me.
Mm, who is
Exactly, yeah. Because I wear little except ermine and fur and pearls and crowns and things like that.
Of course.
I was spending some time with a friend of mine called Mark doing a role play job last week, and I didn't think Mark was that posh. He told me, just quite by the by, that he spent a couple of weeks ago, his father used to be the governor of the small volcanic island of Montserrat. And Mark made me very green by telling me a story about flying in a twin-propeller aeroplane with Sir George Martin, whose air studios are, of course, on Montserrat, and hearing the story of the recording of the Beatles at the air studios and of police and all that sort of thing. And there was Mark telling me the story, and I thought, that's posher than me, and it's cooler than me.
That's so posh.
Yeah, so it's not. It didn't happen to me. That interesting thing didn't happen to me. And my friend Mark.
Harry, have you either met anyone interesting or been in a tent in a living room this week?
No.
Cheers, mate. BBC Six Music, The Steve Show with me, Stephen Merchant, and my cronies. And that's Love in Spoonful, What a Day for a Daydream from 1966.
Steve, hearing the Loving Spoonful again, and wasn't it good to hear that? Reminded me.
Thanks very much.
That was very, very
thanks.
Radio.
That was very radio. Great one, wasn't to it? Be. Reminded me that the music trivia fans will know that there are three bands who are named after male ejaculate.
Oh.
One is the Loving Spoonful. Jude, you know the second one, don't you?
10cc.
10cc.
10cc, yeah.
And a friend of mine was asking me this question and said, and who's the third one? And I said quite innocently, take that.
Wow.
Yeah. turns out it's not Take That.
Is it not Take That?
No, no, that's no. Dan, did you have an idea about who it might be?
I believe there's a singer-songwriter called Dick Gravy.
Dick Gravy?
Yeah.
Sure, yeah. I've enjoyed his work.
Yeah.
Very good, sir. The third band is neither of those. It's actually an obscure American band called Thin White Rope.
Thin White Rope?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Maybe I'm thinking we should put out a cry to our listeners if they've got ideas for who it might have been, but it feels like
it would be
something that's inappropriate.
Yeah, it'd be the lowest that we've ever stooped in getting people to text or email in, I think, wouldn't it?
So, 64046, Stephen.6 music. Yes, thank you for... Dan, one of the other things I was going to add to the list of things for our forthcoming lavatory book.
Yeah.
All right,
yeah, yeah,
we've already got it out there. Things you've said that you can't take back, things that parents have said to you or other people that you wish they hadn't. And the other thing I was going to add was your worst day ever. Because I remember you were reminding me of what what really was one of the grimmest times in your life.
Oh, yes. Yeah, you're thinking about my 27th birthday.
That was one, yeah.
Yeah, which at the time ranked number 27 out of all the birthdays I'd had.
Right, in terms of the good ones.
You want me to share that with people?
Well, I think as an example of what the sort of thing we might have in the book.
Okay, well, the edited version and slightly cleaned up version as well would be that I woke up on my 27th birthday. Normally you'd be full of life,
yeah,
ready to open the presents and the like. I was immediately sick.
Sure.
And then I kind of gathered myself together. I walked into work. My birthday's in February. It was horrible. It was grey. It was cold. Yeah. It was unpleasant. I walked into work. I lost my job.
Really?
Yeah. I was made redundant on my 27th birthday.
Okay, great. So, how long from the moment you walked in the door to when you were actually fired?
Probably about 10 minutes.
That's
I'd
nice.
Say. Yeah.
Pop your coat on the hook, Dan, and come into the office.
It was redundancy as well, so I've got the moral high ground there. I wasn't fired for some misdemeanour. It was, the firm had run out of money, so they couldn't pay me. So,
and you're the first man out the door.
Yeah, I was gone, so I was sick again.
Right. Was that in anything to do with the firing? Or that
well,
was...
I think later
we'll explore
that. But just suffice to say, I didn't know at that time why I was constantly being sick. But,
sure.
So I've got to midday on my 27th birthday. I've been sick twice. I've lost my job. I go out onto the cold, mean streets of Bristol.
Yes.
I'm walking with a couple of fellow redundees.
Sure.
We're thinking, well, let's get on benefits straight away. Let's get
of course. That was
let's interesting. Get down the old job centre. Yeah. Now, on my way there... I've ever so slightly
right.
I've ever so slightly soared myself.
You've ever so slightly soared yourself on the way to the DSS.
Not very badly, just a bit.
Sure.
I'm with former
even a little bit is enough.
A little bit, and I'm thinking, what do I do? I want to stop, and I've got to keep going because I'm with people. And if I stop, I'll have to explain why I stopped.
Yeah.
And I have to explain what I've done.
Sure.
So I've carried on walking on this horrible grey kind of day with soil, if you like, upon my person
for some.
With some salt, yeah.
I've reached the job seekers, the job centre for a job seekers allowance interview.
Yeah.
So I'm in a job seekers allowance interview, having just lost my job on my 27th birthday. I've been sick. I'm sat in my own.
Yeah.
On my 27th birthday.
Yeah.
And just wait. You know, trying to get some benefits, trying to get me £40 a week,
sure,
or whatever, to see me through it. I sort of thought at that point, it's not a great day.
It's not shaping up well, is it?
No. So you'll be pleased to know things got no worse after that point. I bottomed out.
Well, that happened on the walk.
Well, yeah, I suppose. I made it home eventually.
Right.
Salvation came in the form of my my parent, who came and picked me up, took me home.
Yeah.
Had to cancel the meal that we had booked for the evening. I think I'd gone down with some low-level food poisoning.
Of course.
Which explains some of the earlier mishaps. And spent my birthday evening eating a small part of a bowl of tinned mushroom soup, watching Coronation Street, and going to bed.
Oh. God, if you weren't as stable as you are, that's the sort of thing that would have sent you over the edge, isn't it?
Yeah, it wasn't great. It wasn't a great time for me, to be honest. No.
And did you bounce back?
Well, within a year, I was working at the BBC, so that just shows you they'll take anyone.
They will indeed, yeah, absolutely. What a heartening story.
Fantastic piece of lady rock action. But the main reason for picking it is often I'm sort of stopped in the street and people say, Harry, love the Steve show, been listening since day one. I love the gang of zany cronies, you know, sure, they're often interesting and hilarious. But whatever happened to Mr. Fiendishly Difficult Music Question?
Sure.
And, you know, I don't hold back. I tell them about the contractual wrangle, the, you know, the legal stuff and the knife fight in the car park.
Yeah.
And, you know, he just couldn't come back. But they say, but we love questions. We love quizzes.
Sure, of course they do.
And so I thought, well, if we play this track by Veruca Salt, I could say, and I'll open it up to everyone in listener land and in the studio, if you can spot the obscure Beatles reference in the lyrics to this song.
The world is in financial crisis. That doesn't stop banker Harry from still finding time to choose old rock treats. Veruca Salt and Volcano Girls. And you threw a question at us there, Harry, and was the answer?
Well, the obscure Beatles reference. Roof, you've got an idea?
I did hear Here's Another Clue for You, but it wasn't Here's Another Clue for You All, as in The Walrus Was Paul. Was that anything to do with it?
It was, Glass Onion by the Beatles. Lennon says, here's a clue for you all, The Walrus Was Paul. Here's The Seether Was Louise, and The Seether was Veruca Salt's big breakthrough hit. Very nerdy and worthy question.
That is worthy of the obscure music reference quiz.
But talking about financial meltdown, 2 weeks ago on this very show, you said, is it all over? I said, it's going to get worse. Some big bank's going to go down. I was right.
You were.
You heard it here first.
What next? Are we all going to be paying crazy interest rates and have our homes repossessed in about a year's time?
Yeah, it's all over.
Thank you very much. Another fascinating insight from a seasoned professional. This is going to seem... You know when someone prefixes a question or a statement with, I don't want to seem racist, but... Well, no, listen, this is not a bit of shtick. This is a genuine question because it has perplexed me. And it's perplexed me for some time. And I was reminded of it again last night, eating some fantastic Asian fusion food, you know, because I'm super hip and trendy last night. And I'm using the chopsticks. I'll be honest with you, I'm a master of the chopsticks. Chinese people themselves have seen me eating with chopsticks and said, you're an absolute master. Do you know what I mean? Seriously, people have been impressed by I've had no lessons. I can just, I'm a master of the chopsticks.
You've not had lessons?
Never had lessons. I picked up a couple of sticks early on, snapped them apart, fingers, knew the positioning, everything. Dynamite, right? So I'm doing all the methods, scooping and everything. But questions always perplex me. Why the chopsticks? Firstly, why did they originate? Okay, I mean, I know how they originated in China and so on, and they spread around a lot of that Asian area, but why the chopstick? As Jerry Seinfeld points out, famously, you know, they've seen the fork.
Mm.
Why are they not going with the fork? It's not like there's people tilling the land in China with a couple of pool cues. They've seen the fork. And my question is, what the spoon and the fork developed elsewhere in the world, why the chopstick? And moreover, why maintain the chopstick usage all these years later? Mm. It's a genuine question that I'm genuinely perplexed by, because it doesn't seem like an instinctive item to come up with, you know, because it's quite tricky. I mean, as I say, I'm a master of it, but do you know what I mean? To have the sticks between the fingers, the spoon or the fork, very easy, you just shovel into the mouth, but the chopstick...
Especially eating rice, you know. It's probably the most difficult food to eat with chopsticks.
I mean, I know a lot of the food over there is quite sticky, and consequently... but I don't see why that particularly wouldn't be helped with the spoon.
Do you know what? This will surprise you, but I woke up thinking about this very quickly.
Really?
I did. I woke up thinking about the Seinfeld line about, you know, I admire the Chinese because they're sticking with the chopsticks. Yeah, now. They're keeping on with them. Because I realized...
I like the idea that this is a man who proposed to his girlfriend on Friday night, but he's waking up thinking about chopsticks.
I think they do. They chop up all of the meat, particularly before cooking it, whereas we tend to cook it in the piece and then chop it up afterwards with the knives and forks. But they don't do any chopping as part of the eating process.
I see. Is that a chicken and egg situation? Is it because of the chopsticks causing problems with eating?
Yeah.
Therefore, they're not doing any of the chopping later?
I don't know.
I mean, all I'm saying is, I don't know if there's anyone out there who can answer this question, maybe a historian of Chinese history, a Chinaman, maybe. Can we still say that? Is that loud? A Chinaman or a Chinawoman? Yeah. Mm-hmm. If they know the answer, 64846 at stephen.something.
Six music.
And this is not, as I say, it's not a bit of business, not a bit of shtick. I genuinely am always, I've been perplexed, and I've always thought with the radio, it's a great way to source information and answers.
Steve, you said you'd got nothing for today. That's brilliant.
About other nonsense. Sammy, I've been so rude, I've not even asked you how your week's been. I want to obviously quickly find out how the photography class is going.
It's very sad. The nervous man has finally dropped something. The course.
He's dropped the course.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a shame. We were hoping that his catchphrase, "Don't give it to me, I'll only drop it," will sweep the nation. But what a great shame that we're never going to hear that again.
No.
So he's obviously got so panicky at the thought of it. I wonder what else he ventures on. I wonder if he goes on to different lessons, different subjects, you know. And
I don't know what's going to be of an apt level for him. I was trying to think of different classes.
Cushion holding class.
Mime, perhaps.
Mime, yeah.
Yeah.
That would be nice, yeah.
And bizarrely, now this is actually upset me all week, or made me ponder all week. The slightly eccentric fellow.
The tramp.
Yep. You said it, I didn't.
Yeah.
This time. Came up to me on Tuesday and said, "Hello, what's your name?" And I was like, "Oh, that's nice. My name's Sammy, what's yours?" And he said his name and then smiled at me and walked away. And I thought, that was, you know, it was nice, it was friendly, introduced himself. But he looked at me a little bit too long, and then I thought, on the radio last Sunday, I said, "Do you know what, I don't even know his name. I think he listens."
Well, what kind of hobo is he's got a digital radio?
So this is what's making me think more and more he's an eccentric.
He might
he's
hang around in Dixon's.
Yeah, that's what I do.
Yeah.
Or he could have stolen a computer from a tip, got it working. Got on the internet. Got on the internet and listened online.
Sure, yeah.
Possible.
Yes,
so he
lives in the Beano, where such things are possible. Where would he plug it in, Daniel? You've not thought this through at all.
Well, he's rigged up some sort of clockwork internet connection.
A fellow tramp is just cycling furiously.
Yeah, it's an exercise bike, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah. Good. Well, let's say hello to him. We should have tramp news. What's hot in the world of tramps? You know, what tips are easy access late at night if you need to scavenge for computers or other electrical equipment? It's a whole new feature. All right, here's the news. From the album Kiss Me, Kiss Me, Kiss Me, of course, that's The Cure and Why Can't I Be You. It's The Steve Show, BBC Six Music, with me, Stephen Merchant. And my crony is Tiny Tiny Dan.
Hello.
We've got Harry, he's a banker.
Hi.
Sammy from the North. Hello. And Jude pressing the buttons, clinically insane. And you're welcome, very welcome to the show. It's the last half hour, obviously. In fact, we've had a good chunk of that already, so I ought to not talk as much and play more music. Although we were trying to collate earlier things you've said, you've blurted out, which you wish you could have taken back. And I remember one that I did, which, you know, I mentioned earlier about my problem with meeting celebrities, particularly people I admire enormously.
Mm, yeah.
I feel this urge to just seem sort of a bit rude, a bit naughty, a bit edgy with them. So it's, you know, I'm joking around like I'm a peer and not a fan, so that they don't think I'm just some kind of fawning sycophant. And I remember the first time I ever met Steve Coogan, who I adore. I think he's amazing, obviously. Partridge, fantastic. Saxondale, I think, is amazing. I love what he does. But I'd just seen that film he did, The Parole Officer, which I was not a huge fan of. I just thought it was a little bit of a disappointment because I was expecting, you know, something like Partridge. So it was great. Not a bad film, but I just was slightly disappointed. And so I was walking along the road with my erstwhile colleague, R. Gervais, and saw Coogan coming the way. And I thought, oh, brilliant, Steve Coogan. Oh, and I thought, oh, my God, I mustn't mention The Parole Officer. Do not mention the film The Parole Officer. You've seen it. It's a little bit of a disappointment. Just keep thinking about all the great things he's done. Don't mention that one that you thought was slightly below par. And so he came up, and he's chatting away, and we're like, a mutual kind of backslapping. And he went, oh, I'll tell you, I love your guys' writing. If my career is ever on the slide, you know, then you should get in touch.
Oh, no.
And I went, well, we better get in touch now, then. It's just blurring it out straight away. Just come out like that.
That's ridiculous.
Just straight out, like a kind of, like a verbal diarrhea. You better get in touch now then.
thus implying his career was on the skids, right? Yeah. Just because I was thinking about the parole officer and trying not to mention it. Didn't mention it, but consequently made it even more offensive and more...
Did he get in touch?
Well, he sort of kind of acknowledged this, and Ricky obviously looked at me like, careful, what are you doing? And then we sort of carried on chatting, but you could tell there was something had happened to the conversation. It was not going to continue as it was. And then he sort of looked at me kind of midway through, and he just went, sorry, what do you mean? And I went, sorry, no, I was just joking. I was just being flippant. And the whole thing just sort of ended in kind of an awkwardness, a sort of muddy awkwardness, conversational awkwardness. And I don't think I've ever really seen him since. And he fled to America. So fearful was he of my vitriol. But you can see how easy it is. You know, again, that was done from love. Mm. It was fear born out of love that caused me to upset one of my comedy heroes. So you can see how easy it is, but maybe we'll add that to the list. Tiny, 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 tiny Dan, it's your choice of tune.
Yes, yeah, amazing that I get a whole song despite being so small.
Yes,
so that's nice.
It's beautiful.
A bit of soul, Steve. Not enough soul on the show, so yep. I'm going to bring a bit of soul into this. I'm not going to say too much about it. It's by Reuben Bell. It's super jock, but I think you'll enjoy the lyrics, which are basically a eulogy to the fantabulous DJ.
I've got a couple of questions, which I'll be asking these guys later, including, of course, super posh Rufus, who I imagine not only adores, dreams of rugby, knows every inside and out, probably has played it many, many times.
I've got a distant, distant chance that I actually was involved in the invention of it as well.
Almost certainly a relative has been involved with it. We'll play another tune and then we'll find out what's going on inside a scrum. The track is called A Bigger Splash, and it's from a new album called As Found, from French pop rockers Fugu. I play that for all the mournful Frenchies listening who were whipped in the rugbication game that was played last night. And, much as I, you know, obviously I am a very patriotic man, as you know, nationalistic fervour swept the nation as we whipped the old enemy last night. Or was that the Germans? I can never forget. Who do we hate more? I can't remember. But, it's all very exciting and everything, and obviously it's good in balls getting kicked by Johnny, what's his name? And that's all excellent. No, it's great. I love it.
Johnny English.
I love rugby. But, some of it, obviously I know what's going on, you know, when you run with the ball and everything. Ball, funnier shape. It's funny shape, isn't it, the ball? Have you noticed that, Sammy? Funny shape ball, not like a regular ball. But what is going on inside the scrum? I don't understand. I remember playing rugby, but I can't remember what was going on inside it.
But no one knows. No one knows. Little tiny Dan here, obviously. Yeah. When I played rugby at school, I wasn't even allowed in a scrum. Because
of course
it was obvious I'd be
killed.
You
were allowed to play rugby?
No, I wasn't.
Were you the mascot?
I was far too small. Yeah, I could be a mascot. Yeah, absolutely. I could lead them out alongside the cockerel. although it would peck me because it was much larger.
But
no one goes. It's one of the great mysteries of sport, the middle of the scrum, you know, and the people who are involved never speak about it.
Right, now I should just introduce my little mob here in case you're a newcomer to the show. The far corner there. Now, we discover we're panning this, right? So out of what speaker could you hear Harry now?
Left.
Out of the left.
Out of the left
bit. What do you mean left and a bit of the right? Can we just have him all left? All left, fully left.
Oh, no.
Right, so if you're listening in super stereo, then you've got Harry there in the far left.
Hello.
And then, is that? Well, I'm not listening
that's
on the...
That's proper weird.
That's really good. And so where's Tiny Dan?
Dan's a bit further to the middle from there.
Yeah. I'm mostly left a little bit right.
Can you make him really low on the left? So it's as though he can just, he's barely listening, he's barely talking into the speaker.
Hello? Yeah. Can you hear me now?
And then where's super posh Rufus? Is he right in the middle?
No, you're right in the middle.
I'm right in the middle, am I?
He's a little bit to the right.
So if I talk now, then here I am. I'm on your right-hand side, listeners.
Wow, this is extraordinary. This is amazing.
It's like tomorrow's world.
It is. I'm so pleased that in 2007 we're just discovering the joys of stereo. And then where's Sammy?
Where am I?
Right,
wow, this is brilliant. We're so excited about this. And anyone listening on a little mono thing has got no idea how the thrills are.
It doesn't make sense because I'm hearing people now, but they're not where I'm hearing them.
No.
I'm looking at Sammy and she's not where I'm hearing her.
Calm down, mate. Don't ruin the majesty. This is brilliant. This is like a Pink Floyd album come to life. And so anyway, we're talking about the scrum. So why do we go into the scrum?
They say that being in a scrum, being in an international rugby match, is a bit like being in seven minor car accidents.
Really?
They say
that's how much jolts your body.
Yeah, well, your body goes through. The whiplash of going into the scrum, engaging like that, just completely tears your body to pieces. If you and I, if anybody in this room went through a rugby match, we would be in hospital for several weeks, even if we weren't tangibly injured.
Yeah.
But why they do it, well, we won't go into the boring...
What's going on inside?
Well, Steve, when I was
chatting?
When I was in school, I was in the front row of the scrum.
Were you?
Quite a sizable fellow then, and maybe even now. Yeah. I used to get involved in the scrum, and it's essentially a lot of grabbing rubbing, sweating, and biting and shouting.
But what's happening with the ball? Are you just trying to grab it from each other? Is it
well,
that
no, basic? The ball is rolled in.
That's an important point here, Harry. That sounds literally like one of my friend's favourite porn films. That's horrendous. That's not sport. Mm. That's an excuse.
And much like that film, you need a good bath afterwards to sort yourself out. But yeah, basically, the ball is fed in and it gets hooked back. Let's not get too
spend the whole show
scrumming. The ball kind of got left by the wayside. The ball disappeared between someone's legs, and then they carried on scrumming. It seemed like they'd missed the point, and they just loved the scrum.
As long as the ball stays on the ground behind the back foot of the back of the rear player, it's still essentially in the scrum. So you can just keep pushing towards their line, and if the ball stays behind the player's foot, then it's still in the scrum, and no one else can touch it or pick it up. It has to stay where it is until someone in the...
But sometimes they just go into a scrum. They don't sit there and look carefully formalised. They just go into it at some point. Then what's going on?
That's called a maul.
That's a maul. That's not even a scrum. Yeah.
Okay. And when the ball then drops, if the ball is then usually forced to the ground, and then it's a ruck.
Right. And so what's going on then? Are they all just trying to grab it? They're trying to tug it? It's like pass the parcel? Like a vicious pass the parcel?
When you're in a maul, you can grab it off the opposition player. But once it touches the ground, no hands are allowed near the ground. And that's a lot of penalties are given away because someone tries to pick it up when it's on the ground. And that's a penalty.
Hey, are you a lady? Do you not understand rugby? 64046, if you've got questions, stephen.6music@bbc.co.uk. It's public service broadcasting at its very, very best. Coming up later on the show. But what's been happening in your world before you pledge? Can you just give us a little portrait of the week?
Yeah, well, woke up yesterday morning, the girlfriend wakes up, she says, "Jeez, look at the size of that." I knew immediately she was looking out the window. So I looked out the window as well, and about 50 feet away in a garden three houses down, there's a huge old tree, and there's an owl sat in the tree. And the owl, it's a big owl, it's about a foot and a half tall, it's looking away from us, and it's a huge owl. And we back onto a massive park as well, so it, you know, there's every chance that, you know, it is an actual owl. So I get the camera, I'm running around the bedroom trying to get the best shot of this owl. I get a couple of decent shots of this owl, I think, but it's not really good enough. What I need, I'm going to get the camcorder, because it's got a better zoom on it.
Sure.
So I get the camcorder out, and I'm sat in my pants in the bedroom shooting this owl with the video camera out the window. The owl's not moving. It's still looking the other way. It's not moving at all. And I'm sat there for about 10 minutes, and my arm starts to hurt. So I think, I'll give this up. 15 minutes later, go back into the bedroom. Holly goes, it moved. And its head had rotated, as owl's heads do.
Yeah.
And it was looking to the side now. So I thought, right, I'm going to get it when its head moves. So I sit there, and my arm's wobbling. And because there's a long zoom on it, it's not a great shot of the owl. And its head moves. And you know the shots of the Loch Ness Monster, when people, you know, they're training on Loch Ness, and then something happens, and the camera goes wobbly. Yeah. You can't see what happens. So you can't really see what happens. So I don't have a tripod at home. I set up a contraption with a bedside table, put a book on the table, got a pen, put it under the front cover for a bit of elevation. Clever. So I could get the perfect view of this owl. And its head rotates, and I capture its head rotating. It just doesn't look right. But Holly's very excited. She's thinking about, we're going to burn this DVD and send it back to her parents in Australia. Look at the owl in the garden. Went into the lounge.
That'll be killer. They would look forward to that.
They're big bird lovers.
Sure. Who isn't?
But went onto the computer, and I just thought, I'll just Google plastic owl rotating head.
Sure.
And the exact owl. There's one company in America that makes this owl, and our neighbours have bought it, imported it from America. It's the exact owl. And they've gone to the trouble to go 50 foot up this tree to put this owl up there. Just
to put a plastic rotating head owl?
It's mental. It's absolutely bizarre.
And either of those neighbours had seen you in your underpants putting so much effort into filming their owl, it was worth it.
It was worth that $12.99.
It was worth it.
And also, why not just send those photos anyway to Australia? They wouldn't be able to tell, would they?
Well, I'm thinking of burning the DVD and putting it through the door of the neighbours, just so they can see what a frantic morning I had trying to get pictures of this owl.
I'm amazed that you...
BBC Six Music.
BBC Six Music.